Massachusetts people, past and present, whose name was appropriated by this Commonwealth. We pay respect to the Massachusetts elders, past and present. We name and recognize the Massachusetts people as the traditional stewards of this land, and we acknowledge the enduring relationship that exists between them and their traditional territories. We admit the truth of violence perpetrated against the indigenous peoples of this land. Perpetrated, moreover, both in the name of this country and in the name of Christ. And we make a commitment to uncovering that truth. We comprehend the land acknowledgement is a small yet important step towards ensuring a culture of respect, truth, and accountability in our church, in our city, in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and in our nation.
Together in the call to worship. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world.
From everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
For 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, or like a watch in the night.
You sweep them away, they are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning.
Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations.
So teach us to count our days, that we may gain a wise heart.
Beloved, there is a peace that surpasses all understanding, a peace that this world did not give, and therefore this world cannot take away. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Also with you.
Share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. Beloved ones, welcome to the Old South Church Meeting House. Welcome to our ancestral home. Our forebears would not have guessed nor desired that 354 years later, their pulpit would be composed of entirely women. But as we know full well, God is still speaking, always urging us toward freedom and healing, repentance and grace. And so welcome. Welcome you queer, questioning, and straight. Welcome you cis, non-binary, and trans. Welcome you who have always felt welcome at church and in buildings like these. And welcome. Welcome to you who carry the scars of closed doors and closed hearts. We are glad you are here. We gather in the presence of the living God who is always doing a new thing. Welcome to worship. Welcome home. Let us join our voices together in prayer. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Shine, Lord,
Ladies and gentlemen, kids of all ages, welcome to the Big Top, to the major leagues, to the game of life. I'm Miss Kate, and I'm really happy to see all of you. Today, I'm going to tell you a few stories about some brave, expectation-defying heroes. But first, you have a role to play. You didn't think you could just sit there, did you? No, the game of life has no spectators, only participants. So, over here, this first, third, and Reverend Ashley, you are going to be, your line is, snug as a bug in a rug. Please. So when I point over here, excellent, you will say your line, that's great. This next section over here, your line is? Thank you, yes, the line said by all relieved it's in the past. When you see this sign, excellent, excellent. Finally, this section in the middle, You get the brave line. Your line will be, ready or not, here I come. As if you've just counted to 100, but you don't have to count today, okay? Great.
Ready or not, here I come. Ready or not, here I come.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, now. Sit back and hear a tale of a few men just minding their own business in Galilee. Their fishy business. Not like that. They were actually fishermen. These two were brothers, Simon and Andrew, and they were all set. Indeed, they were not out seeking adventure. They weren't chasing waterfalls. They were exactly where they were expected to be. But then someone entered the scene. This guy from Galilee named Jesus just strolled on by one day and said something weird.
Accurate.
Well, yes, sort of. He offered them a new opportunity, a weird opportunity, but they were. Even so, it was an intriguing offer.
Accurate.
And do you know what happened next? They mustered up all of their fears and responded,
ready or not, here I come.
But ready or not, here I come indeed. But it didn't just happen once. No, it happened to another pair of brothers. James and John were also waking up early to mend their fishing nets, working all day on the water, trying to catch some fish, sleeping at night in their childhood homes. Perfectly okay with what they were doing. Enter that strange guy, Jesus, and he said to them, again, maybe not a direct quote, but do you know what they did? They also left their dad. Their dad Zebedee was right there in the boat with them. And they left him. They left a comfortable home where they had been. And after Jesus said, they immediately responded. Without thinking about it for a second. So for you and me, we're entering this comfy, cozy season. We are safe here. We've got families. We've got jobs and responsibilities and all sorts of things that help us to be. But look out, because there's this wild guy from Galilee who might just reach out and say, and then you will be faced with the hard and brave decision of whether to follow. You may need to take a turn you were not planning on. You may need to study something that you never imagined that you would. When you say to him, you may really not feel ready. But what a wonderful thrill of unexpected adventure he offers. On your marks, get set, go. Will you pray with me? Dear ringmaster of all, the great creator of this wild and woolly game of life, we thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus, who invites us all, ready or not, into new paths for the greater good. Help us to be brave when presented with new challenges. Help us to bring light and laughter to the journey, and always be with us as we wander about following your call. We pray this in the name of your son, Jesus, and we all say, amen. Thanks, friends.
A reading from the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. As Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called to them. Immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. May we be blessed with understanding. And will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Each year we return here to our ancestral home, here the Old South Meeting House, to remind ourselves not only of our deep roots, but also of our deeply held values. Freedom of conscience, the calling to bravely speak truth to power, the rights of liberation and self-determination which have been fought for on this hallowed ground. We hear echoing in the rafters the booming voice of Samuel Adams and the other patriots of the American Revolution. We gaze up to the balconies, and we remember our African members like Phyllis Wheatley, who would have been relegated to those separate pews, yet still heard clearly a gospel preached about liberation and hope. Today, I'd like you to journey with me, if you will, a bit forward in the history of this storied place. The triumph of the revolution is over. The meeting house, which had been turned into a horse stable, has been fully restored, and the congregation worships here again. But now, in a new age of warfare, it's 1864, a decade before the big move to the Back Bay in the final year of the Civil War, and Jacob Manning, Old South Church's 15th minister, is newly returned from 8 months serving as chaplain of the 43rd Tiger Regiment of the Union Army in North Carolina. He shares these words. "The American nation was at first only a purpose, nor has that purpose even yet been overtaken. We doubt if it ever will be. All men are created free and equal. That was the mark which the founders set up, but they knew that the mark was far before them. They utterly failed to reach it when they came to organize the government. It was an ideal. It may never become real in any actual sense, but it is the goal and the guiding star of the nation, standing far off in the future, laying its light across all that was to be and will be of upheaval and bloodshed, and holding up the hearts of those who would make the last result answer to the first promise." How little time it took to set up that far-off standard, which so fired the imaginations of the patriots. How slow and toilsome, amid fierce struggles and many slips backwards, the advance towards it. Yet without this purpose, there would not be the effort at achievement, A nation may fail to reach its ideal, but a nation without an ideal can achieve no progress. In this same year, 1864, on a far distant shore, halfway around the world, a young man named Great Good Fortune, or Shemeta, by his grandfather, was inspired by a similar guiding star. Neijima Shemeta, who we now know by his Americanized name, Neisima Joe Hardy, grew up the eldest son in a samurai warrior family outside of Edo, now Tokyo. When Shemeta was 10 years old, Commander Perry's ships arrived outside of Edo, and this marked the beginning of the Meiji Restoration, a time of modernization and of expanding international trade. As a teenager, Neijima Shemeta discovered an atlas of the United States written in Chinese. His curiosity sparked, he later recalled in his diary, "I read it many times, and I wondered about it so much that my brain practically melted out of my head because I liked it so much." Picking one president, building free schools, poorhouses, vocational schools, and so forth, and I thought that the government of every country should be like the one of the United States. I mourned for the people of Japan who lived under an oppressive government. If you govern us, you must love us as children. From that time, I wished to learn American knowledge. A few years later, he found a small Chinese Bible in a friend's library. He borrowed it and read it at night in secret, for reading the Bible was strictly forbidden under penalty of death. The opening line, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth," moved Neijima Shemeta deeply. He writes, "I put down the book and I looked around me, saying, 'Who made me? My parents? No, my God. God made my parents and allowed them to make me. Who made my table? A carpenter? No, my God. God let trees grow upon the earth. Although a carpenter made up the table, it indeed came from the trees. Then I must be thankful to God. I must believe in God. I must live a life devoted to God.'" He prayed, "Oh, if you have eyes to look upon me, if you have ears, listen to me." From that time, Neijima Shemeta was consumed with a burning desire to learn more about God and the wider world. With great effort, he was able to convince his parents to let him travel to the far-off city of Hakodate. He told his mother that he would be gone a year, but he little suspected that it would be more than 10 years before he would again see his home city and look into the faces of those he loved. With only a small bundle of belongings, he set out like Abraham before him because he felt God calling to him, "Tag, you're it." In Hakodate, he made friends with a clerk who spoke English and was able to secure him passage on an American schooner. On the night of his departure, he dressed as a servant with his bundle on his back and sallied out into the darkness, following one of his friends by back streets down to the water's edge, to a lonely spot where his friends waited with a small boat. He was placed in the bottom of the boat and covered up. It was now midnight. A whispered word of parting, hushed footsteps, the muffled dip of an oar, and the true-hearted young patriot went to seek truth and blessing for his country and had stolen away from her shores like a culprit and was on an American schooner. It was July 1864. When Neijima Shemeta stood at the ship's railing and looked out at the horizon, as he scanned the sky for that guiding star, "All people are free and equal." Could he have pictured in his mind this very place, where revolution walked the floorboards, where liberation echoes from the rafters. As he lay in his bunk, rocked by the swelling waves, reading the New Testament in Chinese language, he would have read of the calling of the first disciples, who left family and home to follow Jesus, and the wise ones from the east who followed a guiding star. In his year aboard the Wild Rover, he began to dream, and the great aim of his life came into focus. He would establish a school in Japan that would introduce Western education and Christianity to the people. Over the next 10 years, Niisama Joe would study and pray, persuade, and make friends here in Massachusetts, all to the purpose of this great aim. Adopted by the owner of the Wild Rover, Alpheus Hardy, who was a member of this church, Niisama Joe would attend Phillips Academy, Amherst College, and Andover Theological School. He was the first Japanese person to receive a degree from a Western college and was the first Japanese Christian minister to be ordained. At the 1874 meeting of the American Board of Commissioners of Foreign Missions, he was commissioned to return to Japan as a missionary and was asked to give a speech. He writes, "When I appeared on the stage, I could hardly remember my prepared piece, a poor, untried speaker. But after a minute or two, I recovered myself, and my trembling knees became firm and strong. A new thought flashed into my mind, and I spoke something quite different from what I had prepared. While I was speaking, I was moved. I was moved to tears with an intense feeling over my fellow countrymen. Before I closed my poor speech, about $5,000 were submitted on the spot to found a Christian college in Japan. Ready or not, here I come." That school would become present-day Doshisha University, a school founded on the conviction that it is not the power of a few heroes that maintains a nation, but rather people of conscience who work to ensure the education, rights, and welfare of others. Freedom of conscience, the calling to bravely speak truth to power, the rights of liberation and of self-determination for all people, this is still our guiding star. Though we recognize with Jacob Manning and Niisama Joe that we are far from it and have not yet arrived. In this time when the horrors of war again dominate the news, when fear and grief grip our hearts and our prayers catch in our throats, may we be inspired by the stories of these wayfinders who set their sights toward a future of hope and gave their full measure for the building up of freedom and justice for all people. May it be so.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to God, the creator of all things visible and invisible, powerful beyond measure, good beyond all understanding.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Let us pray. You may be seated. This morning, O God, we give hearty thanks, O God, for divine gifts granted to us and to this earth, gifts that are greater than we can ask for ourselves.
Thanks be to you, O God.
We remember those coming to these shores, seeking freedom to worship and to build a community with you at its heart. With pungency, pain, and regret, we remember the indigenous inhabitants of this land, ranging from coast to coast, now diminished, victims of those claiming to build a city on a hill. Have mercy on us, O God. We sorrowfully recall oppression visited over the centuries upon Black Americans, immigrants, women, the poor, and the persons of different sexual orientations and gender identities, oppressions enshrined in law and blessed by the church. Forgive us, O God. In a season in which war and incivility and terror, the plight of refugees and the asylum seekers, and the economic chaos wreak havoc with human lives, as hunger, pandemics, and ecological disasters afflict hundreds of millions of our clear kin, and our good earth suffers at human hands, we beg you. God of grace and God of glory, we ask your forgiveness and pray we may recast our priorities to more nearly coincide with those of your Son. Healer of the ill, feeder of the hungry, lover of the outcast, welcomer of the stranger, Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. Have mercy on us, O God, and hear our earnest desire to serve you in your realm all the days of our lives. Thank you, O God, for bestowing forgiveness on those who seek it and those who express a readiness to repent and radically change their ways. Thanks be to you, O God. Thanks indeed to you, O God, forgiver of our sins and provider of all the good gifts of this earth. Thanks be to you, O God. Now let us join our voices and our hearts and pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
response to God's generous invitation to co-creation, to give something back. On this Sunday, we remember the generations of believers who have gone before us, who gave in faith so that we might exist today. God trusts us with resources such that all might have enough. Let us offer our time, talent, and treasure to the kingdom of God. The offering will now be given and received.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. pray and bless these gifts. Generous God, we bring the gifts of ourselves and our abundance. Magnify and multiply these offerings to meet the needs before us. Cultivate the spirit of generosity among us and make us good stewards as we use these gifts in your name. Amen.
Love and care for one another in the name of Christ, and may the Spirit of God, which filled James and John, Jacob and Joe, fill your hearts, souls, and minds. May the power of God, which upheld them, strengthen you for each day. And may the love of God, which directed their every action, be your guiding light and your shining star, both now and forevermore. And let the whole church say, Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.